50 years ago, the International Brigade marched through Barcelona in the shadow of the victory of fascism in Spain and throughout Europe. Today, after 50 years, the veterans of the brigade are back. Back in a democratic Barcelona, in a democratic Spain.
I went to Barcelona to take part in the unveiling of a memorial to the dead of the International Brigade who fought on the side of the Republic during the so-called Spanish Civil War.
We were there to try to secure the victory of the legitimate government of the country.
We were youth with a conscience. Spain, to me, represented the finest thing that I ever was associated with. It was an honor to have participated alongside the Spanish people.
Left Northumberland and Down. These 25 were killed in Spain. So they always keep coming back. The memory of them keeps coming back.
You had a number of traitorous generals who used their power over the army to plot against the legitimate government of their country. I'd been brought up as a socialist, as a trade unionist. I'd been in the mines, I'd seen what the mines, what working in the mines meant to our people in South Wales anyway. And if socialism isn't international, it's nothing.
The American ambassador, he didn't actually repudiate that it was a civil war, but in a message to Roosevelt, he said that this is an uprising of an army, a whole army, against the people. I was associated always with the left. We were brought up in the slums of Dublin. I didn't want to leave Ireland. But circumstances forced me, apart from the Spanish War, I didn't want to leave. Circumstances, unemployment, the misery here, the slums, the total intellectual blackout. There was other developments happening throughout the world. There was the rise of the Nazis in 1933, immediately followed by the pogroms against the Jews. And here, the communists were the victims. This was the type of thing that was developing in other countries, the hysteria, the anti-communist hysteria.
For 21 years, Britain has not suffered such a terrible tragedy as that which has overtaken the Gresford Colliery at Wrexham in North Wales. Over 100 men were trapped in a flaming tomb when explosions cut off their escape, half a mile below the surface of the earth. Rescue parties have worked unceasingly since the disaster occurred. Some of these brave men have lost their lives in attempting to save their imprisoned comrades. Yet the gallantry of these others remains unimpaired.
So they were asking for volunteers. Apparently you couldn't stay down too long. So I said to my friend, well, I'm going down. Well, he said, you'll ruin your suit. I know, I said. It was like throwing a bucket of water on a blazing tanker, as it were, you know, it was useless. Then we were talking about going further to try and get to see if there was anybody left alive. It was quite obvious. It was Dante's Inferno. It made me a very angry person. And quite frankly, when I look back, I'm still angry. I felt we were treated like morons, and that the people at the top thought we were morons and just slaves to be sent to do anything, to die for our country and also to die at work for our country and to be half-starved in the meantime.
The 200 men bear a petition signed by 12,000 Jaddo people to draw the attention of London and Parliament of their stricken town. The oldest marcher, George Smith, is 62. Jaddo's unemployed are all but 1,300 of a population of 35,000. staying the night at a school in Mill Hill, each man is given 2 shillings from a fund raised by sympathizers. In his petition, Jarrow calls on Parliament to rescue the derelict town.
Most of the men of the brigade came out of a European working class hammered by unemployment and fascism. Frank Graham, a student, came out of the travail of the northeast of England.
Everywhere in Europe, fascist movements, organized and directed and financed by Hitler and Mussolini, were on the march. And we realized that if something wasn't done to stop it, then, of course, eventually it would lead to a world war. Now, Spain became one of the key points in this struggle. It was obvious when Franco seized power, attempted to seize power in Spain with the help of Hitler and Mussolini, that that was another step towards the Second World War.
And I became very active in the unemployed workers' movement and was involved in the hunger march of 1936, went on that, and then, of course, we were preoccupied with events in Spain.
First of the actual pictures from Spain in revolt, Gaumont British News tells a graphic story of bloodshed and violence. The land of smiling tomorrow is grim today. Through the streets of Madrid, naked murder is stalking.
This British newsreel suppresses the truth. There were naked murders on the Republican side, but they were nothing compared to the hideous killings in the Franco zone, where the fascist phalange practiced systematic massacre. The Republic had to organize a people to fight its own army. The Western democracies denied the Spanish government its legitimate right to buy arms. Spanish democracy was betrayed. It needed all the help it could get. It was the volunteers of the International Brigade who rallied to newborn Spanish democracy in its hour of need.
I went to the Communist Party, which was the recruiting agency in London, and told them that I was going to jump my ship in Alicante. And because I'd been to Spain now and had a good bit of knowledge, and I even had a fair bit of knowledge of the language, having previously spoken Gaelic, I was quickly able to learn the language. I wouldn't say I've learned everything, but I do know there's 15 conjugations to a Spanish verb. That's more than I don't know all them, but I know only professors use them. But so the Communist Party told me that they'd rather I went across the Pyrenees with a group. We were given a pair of alpargatas, just rope shoes, and warned about smoking, no lights, no talking, and be careful about rocks, of disturbing rocks. That was the idea of the soft shoes, because fascist patrols were operating in the Pyrenees.
Early in 37, one of the fellows who was active in South Wales in the political movement came to see me one day in Rumney and said, "Are you still mindful to go to Spain?" And I said, "Well, I've been trying to save up enough to get my train fare ready." Oh, he said, "You don't have to worry about that. There's a party going out from South Wales on a given date, and all you've got to do is to go down to Charles Street in Cardiff, and that'll be that." Having told my father what I was going to do, he didn't object. It was what I wanted to do. Told a couple of my friends that I was going. Told them to keep mum about it for about 3 weeks, if they were asked where I was, that I'd gone off to look for a job or something, and away I went.
It never worried me in the fact that you might get killed, because already some had gone back, and there'd been quite a number of them killed, from Britain, of course, and you knew that was the fact that it could happen, but I think you just accepted it. And you just went out disregarding the fact that you might not return.
I thought, well, we must go and help them somehow or other. And I went to see a fellow called Robson, who was then, I think, one of the chiefs in the Communist Party of Great Britain. He told me the same story. "It's a rough and tough war," he said. "A lot of people are getting killed. A number of our British have already been killed," he said. "So you understand that if you go there, you're not liable to come back." "Well," I said, "it's bound to happen in any war. And then I understand you've got some military experience." "Yes," I said. "So, well," he said, "right. I only told one person, a friend of mine, that I was going. I told my parents I was going for a weekend to Colwyn Bay. Instead of that, I went to London. And I was told only to bring a pair of socks and a small suitcase, just a change of underclothing.
This is Madrigueras, a village near the town of Albacete in La Mancha, Don Quixote's country, the base of the international brigades. To this area came over 40,000 men from most of Europe and some of the Americas. They came here through a sea of revolutionary songs and clenched fists. Here they were classified according to military skills, if any, sorted into language groups. The British and the Americans, with the Irish distributed between them, were here in Madrigueras and at Chorizona, down the road. This church was their mess hall, and here they got what training they did get.
Next question was, did I have any knowledge of arms? And I told them, yes, that I had only in the IRA. I knew how to use a revolver, a rifle, and ballistics. And because of that, then I was to be put into the training school, and so I was taking out platoons, drilling them only with a wooden rifle. We hadn't had a rifle in the whole base. And we had really professionally made wooden rifles. So I'd march them up and down and round in circles and digging potholes, while the peasants in the fields where we'd be training were measuring out the land, dividing it up amongst themselves.
The basic motive of all of us was that the cancer that was spreading through Europe was now getting its latest victim in Spain, and that we had an obligation, since we believed in humanity and the concept of collective security against aggressors, that the proper place to be was supporting the Republic. And the best way to put that into practice was to get out to Spain and help the legitimate government of the Republic, which we did, as volunteers.
Nice to see you.
When the tide came again, we got out in Barcelona, and then big crowds of people waiting for us there. There was about 300 or so on the ship, and we marched through the Las Ramblas in Barcelona. Oh, well, the situation in Barcelona was terrific as far as we were concerned. The flags of all the various political parties, and there were a lot of political parties in Spain then, socialists, communists, and so on. There was left Republicans, apart from the anarchists, too, were very strong in the Catalonian area, where Barcelona is the capital. And the people were clapping, and we were singing and waving to them.
Yes, inauguration of the monument by the mayor of Barcelona. We were shock troops. We knew what the odds were from the beginning. We were told it was almost certain death. We wouldn't. There was no illusions. When you were interviewed in King Street, you were told, and now is your time to turn back. That's just going to be no bed of roses out there. It's going to be difficult, the extreme, you won't get food. There'll be all this and that, and it didn't put off anyone, to my reckoning. So no one went in there innocent.
The ordinary people, the campesinos, felt free that they had their liberty for possibly the first time. And they weren't going to give it up very lightly.
As the roll of guns comes ever nearer, our cameraman shows the demonstration against the rebels. Everyone in the capital is pressed into service, for now there is no other work than war.
Thousands of civilians swore to stop Franco's army. No pasaran, they shall not pass. The small but highly trained and vicious Army of Africa came sweeping into this tumultuous city. At the first bloody and ferocious shock on the 8th November, the enemy broke into the university, a city just up that road there, but the line held. Weary men braced themselves for the next shock. Then suddenly they heard tremendous cheering from the Gran Via. Up there, 2,000 disciplined men in corduroy uniforms and steel helmets came marching right through the heart of Madrid. The Edgar Andre battalion of Germans with a handful of British machine gunners. The Commune of Paris battalion of Frenchmen and Belgians, the Dombrowski battalion of Poles, all led by a Hungarian. It was the first of the international brigades.
On every hilltop, in hurriedly dug trenches, men of rebel and government parties lie in wait with machine gun and field gun. Every hour from some new direction, the silence of the evening is shattered by the tornado of artillery duel and a rifle's whistling message of destruction.
Bombs on Madrid mean bombs on London. And that made common sense to us. Field Marshal Kesselring, he was in charge of the bombing in Spain. And he was also then in charge of the total blitzes that took place against England, having carried out their exercises to very full effect and practice in the destruction of Guernica.
In that battle for Madrid, the International Brigade marched into history and became legend. Today, some of those living legends are back on the streets of Spain, in Barcelona, a demonstration against NATO and nuclear war.
The Spanish government or the Spanish people owe us nothing. As if there's a question of debt, then that is down to the British government and the Irish government. It's a debt of conscience, particularly the British government, who had appeased Hitler and Mussolini right up to the last.
Whilst we, the International Brigade, had come from many parts of the world, we didn't bring any arms to Spain. All we brought was our enthusiasm to fight for democracy and our enthusiasm to fight on the side of the Republic and fight against Hitler and Mussolini.
Quickly, the French and British government and American invented the idea of non-intervention, thus depriving the democratically elected government of its right to buy arms, which allowed Germany, Italy, Portugal to pour in troops all the time from the beginning.
I had read quite a bit about the history of Spain and the conquistadores and all the rest of it. That blood-stained record ran right through the whole thing.
Oh, well, the Catholic Church had joined Franco, the official Catholic Church. In the Basque Country, the Catholic Church there sided with the Republic. There were royalist elements in Franco's army. So he was playing to the Church and playing to the royalists.
I was always a devout Catholic, and that's one of the reasons I'm a very disappointed one, because I expected a bit more from the Catholic Church, and certainly was horrified to see the deeds of the Catholic Church in Spain. Cardinal Gómez y Tomás, he's made his declaration that blessed are the canons from whose breaches flowed the gospel. And the Pope, at the same time, granted 100 indulgences for every red killed.
This is Suicide Hill, above the bloody valley of the Jarama. Here on the 12th of February 1937, the 600 men of the new British battalion of the 15th International Brigade took the full shock of the advance by Franco's elite troops, the Foreign Legion and the Moors. They had no maps. Three quarters of them had never held a gun before. And from up there in the Pingarón Heights, the enemy belted them with artillery and machine guns for seven unremitting hours. By the end of the day, only 225 were left on their feet. But they stopped fascism in its tracks.
We went over the top, about 50 men, and of those 50, 25 were killed. We were told to retreat, and I was able to get away. And we went out that night to bring in the bodies.
Every battle we fought had its resulting number of deaths or wounds or maybe. And that was a soldier's lot.
The war in Spain drags on. Dispatches from Oviedo, Bilbao, Barcelona.
Anyone going to Spain, you're warned. You're nearly facing certain death.
Our cameramen in the firing line send back these grim pictures of the open warfare of government troops and insurgents.
Things get tough after the first few months. You could be in the front line for 2-3 days without proper food.
Of course, it was simple food. Beans, lentils, the odd scrap of meat.
I never thought I'd see some of those people again. One doesn't expect. A lot of people had died, and they'd changed, of course, in appearance. That was what struck me mostly, I suppose. You forget that you change yourself in 50 years, too, and that other people have a job in recognizing you. Somebody had a photograph, do you know this fellow kind of thing. Oh, he's over there. And there he would be with a, looking quite an old man.
Fighting line, our cameraman is on the spot. Taking some of his pictures from a ruined building and some from an armored car, our cameraman secured this grim record of an attack on the village.
This is a phony film of a fighting near Madrid laid on by Franco for British newsreel creeps. What was real was the doomed and desperate Republican offensive at Brunete. That's Brunete. Then it was July. July on these parched plains of Castile. Awful heat under an implacable sun. A dry, desperate thirst choked the life out of them. And it was a battle of blood. The Francoists cut the legs of 300 Republican prisoners. The Republicans shot 400 Moorish prisoners in revenge. Here died the legendary Major George Nathan, who always carried a gold-topped cane. As he lay dying, he asked his men to sing him out of life. In the end, only 80 of the British battalion were left.
Those dead are remembered today in this striking memorial in Barcelona.
It's a memorial to David and Goliath. You're losing people you've associated with for a while, been in training with them, and you get very close to them, and they become your comrades, and you get to know them by first name. The effect on me was, you see, a man next to his head being blown off, or being opened up by shrapnel, and I saw quite a few like that, and I decided, well, I was worrying about these people, and how sorry I was for them in every way. But I thought, well, this won't do, because if you start doing that, you can't fight. Your job is, whether you like it or not, and if you put a uniform on, you've gone into the battle, your job is to fight. And to put it crudely, to kill the enemy.
Right through the war, I always had the feeling that somehow that I'd get through it and would eventually return. The only thing that really frightened me during the war and got me down was the artillery.
Well, we had undertaken to fight. If you were given the right to bear arms, there are two things that inevitably follow. One, that you have to kill, and B, you have to be prepared to accept the fact that you'll be killed.
Spain gave me, and I think the majority of international brigades, it gave us a new dignity. a dignity that here was a people terribly oppressed, the lowest wages in Europe. They had carried out a democratic election. They were denied the fruits of their effort by a combination of the most reactionary circle in Europe.
It's the most wonderful army in the world when you think of it, that nobody actually organized these people. Nobody organized me. I asked to go. The war in Spain from July 36 was the beginning of the Second World War, and we were the targets for the rehearsal of the German and Italian armies and air forces.
We knew that the consequences would be a Second World War, and we also knew that the consequences of a fascist victory could threaten not only the British Empire, which I didn't bloody well care about, but it certainly would threaten the whole of the British people, of the civilians and all, once Spain became a fascist country.
Now Barcelona is a free city, Catalonia is an autonomous country, Spain is a democracy, and we are able to welcome you full-hearted with our arms stretched like this to say welcome, thank you, forever.
Marcel, señor Valle, gracias, señor alcalde.
I decided that this was certainly an event that I must not miss. Because of the many things that happened to me in Spain, the many moments that moved me, what happened just 50 years ago, yesterday, perhaps was the most emotional moment of my experience in Spain and perhaps of my entire life. I recall very clearly the parade that we had of the international brigades, and I recall women in tears bringing their children so that their children could embrace us and say farewell to us. And of course, most moving of all for me was this great oration of La Passionaria, Dolores Ibarruri. And I recall her expression when she bade farewell to us. She said, "You are the pariahs of the earth, the despised, the rejected, the homeless." And I broke down in tears, and frankly, I feel like crying even now as I recall this, because that certainly was one of the great emotional moments of my life.
It's a difficult proposition to consider the worst moments and the best, because there were so many moments of glory. And the first one to me was having ascended the Pyrenees to be standing on top on Spanish soil, watching the dawn come up from the Mediterranean over the mists and so on below. And I think it was the first time in my life that I appreciated the glory of the Impressionists.
I come round the corner of this ridge, and suddenly I could see the machine guns firing from the church tower, and I was hit. Bullet through the spine, paralyzed, and through my stomach. So I said to Tom Wilde, "I've been hit. You better tell the men to scatter and make the way the best they can. That's the only way you will get out." And I started trying to find my way back. Well, my leg was, one right leg was paralyzed, but otherwise I felt no pain whatsoever. And in fact, I didn't know where I was wounded. It took about, 10 minutes before I realized it was in the stomach, as well as the spine. And I knew then, of course, that I only had about 4 hours to live. If you're not operated on, you would die with a stomach wound of that kind. So all I had to do was to make my way the best way possible to a first aid post. And I decided just to ignore bullets, to ignore everything, because I couldn't walk very far, and just make what I thought was the best place. As I was crossing one field, I saw a man, another soldier, and I shouted to him. I said, listen, in the next field, there's a donkey. He said, where are we? He said, I said, I know the way out if you'll get that donkey. And I'll ride on the donkey, and I'll tell you the way to go. And he went off to get the donkey. I said, in the meantime, I'll go forward. He never came back. He couldn't find us. He got the donkey, he couldn't find me. I met him 4 years later. I was walking down Westcote Road, Newcastle, and I bumped into him. A man called Potts. Never seen him since then to this day.
In my best moments, where when I have been transferred from the prison of Burga, San Pedro de Cardenia, for possible exchange for Italian prisoners, to the prison in San Sebastian, was the attempt, what we believed was a conspiracy, to get us lynched. There was a loudspeaker in the Plaza de San Sebastian, broadcasting to the people walking around the square to come and look at these criminals who came to fight against the Spanish people. They walked us around the square 3 times, and it was obvious there was an attempt to get us lynched so that Franco could say to the world it was the wrath of the Spanish people. Suddenly, a lot of the people disappeared from around the square. They'd gone into the shops and bought up all the chocolate and cigarettes they could get. And they come and pressed these into the hands of the prisoners, and we were then quickly dispatched off to the central prison in San Sebastian. That was not only a pleasant, it was an indication of how the Basque people felt in expressing their solidarity with the prisoners under the Franco regime.
That was a great moment, I could imagine. Yeah. I want to say this, that the Americans as a group, I'd already spoken about it, were the youngest of all the volunteers that had come here from various countries. The Americans as a whole were young people, a lot of them students and young men that had not even become workers because of the Great Depression that the United States had at the time. And consequently, we have more vets today in the United States, veterans of the Spanish Civil War, than any other of the various internationals that came. Some had remained active.
I must say, speaking for the vets organization, that we've done a great deal of work with reference to support for the Nicaraguan people in their brave fight for independence and the right of sovereignty. Our organization has sent, what is it, Nick, some 17 or 19 ambulances, 18 ambulances, and many vets on their own have carried on projects. We had one veteran go down to build homes, Abe Osheroff, to build low-cost housing. And of course, many vets today are involved in the fight against apartheid, putting pressures on the United States government to take a stance against apartheid and to boycott South Africa until they do something about and many vets are interested in other important social issues in our country, like the continued racism in our own country and the matters of the environment, for example, protecting the environment, which incidentally isn't just an issue just for us Americans, it's an issue for the whole world.
Yeah, yeah. We were attacked in the section that I was in. I was in heavy machine guns then. And we'd taken a toll of them, but they took a toll of us too. And in the end, they broke through the ranks and came around the back, and we were all shot down in the trench. And I found there was only 3 of us left. An American sergeant, Joe Kleinman, and the corporal, a Spanish corporal, and myself. I'd been wounded in the arm, half the muscle off, a bullet and some flesh wound. And I was amazed I was still alive.
And then the Spanish corporal got up. And he said, we'll have to get back. But as he stood, all of his intestines came out. He'd been torn by bullets from top to bottom. And he was still alive. He hadn't been injured internally. But when Joe Klein and I looked at each other and looked at him, he dropped dead through shock. And Joe said to me, well, we've done a good job, haven't we? He'd had a bullet in the chest, and I got an old handkerchief from to put in the hole, and then I got a cigarette for him. And he died there and then.
News pictures this week from the land of civil war include these of British prisoners. Some of the army of unemployed enrolled for road making under the Spanish government, but they were captured by the insurgents. Here they are in detention camp, being served out with food of which there is no scarcity.
This despicable Gaumont British news reel is a lie. Those unemployed road builders were soldiers of the International Brigade, and they were starved to the edge of death.
The worst features was hunger, because we were in a state of famine all the time.
They told us that we'd have to give the fascist salute. We asked what would be the consequences if we refused, and he said we'd be shot. Suddenly, a lorry load of civil guards, armed civil guards, come up. I considered them, they were the execution squads of Franco. An officer called out, communists, socialists, Jews, and machine gunners, step forward. But in that moment, there was an effort just to push towards the front, be shot first.
I had the death penalty twice in 1939. It was converted to 30 years, and then British government paid $2 million for my release.
We asked the Irish consul in Paris after I was exchanged with two other Irish that we said to him, we'll send us back to Spain, because he wanted us to sign a document that we'd pay our fares. And then we got a bill from the Irish government for our fares back from a bloody concentration camp. And the Italians were taken back at the expense of the British taxpayer on an Italian warship.
Frank, removed from the shooting war, waged his own war of words. He was sent to Radio Barcelona to broadcast the cause to the world. He was bombarded by more than bombs. The brewery above them was hit, and barrels of beer came thundering down the stairs into the studio.
Pleased to meet you. We very quickly dawned upon us that we couldn't win the war, but we realized the longer we delayed.
Offensive which rocked Franco right down to his German
was dead, did apologize.